I'm going to call the names up, so apologies for mispronunciation, and if I don't manage to see the board, probably. I see someone has already put up a helpful result for us.
Thanks
for
your job.
So to start the debate, call on Aaliyah.
Restroom and didn't expect Niall to walk in. That might be why he's not here today. He might have left after that unfortunate incident. So we lost about 60 seconds at least, and then at least 30 seconds explaining it to Niamh. That was great. But on the more the time that we did have for the motion, what we've decided is we really feel that it's important that this House grant amnesty to all illegal immigrants currently residing in the U.S. And how, Pam, I think this ought to be done is that we should allow, without penalty, illegal aliens, not the green type, to apply for citizenship, work visas, tourist visas, whatever is already available to individuals outside of the U.S., and that they should not, nothing should be held against them for residing in the U.S. illegally before applying for that. We think that's something that we owe to these individuals, specifically because they add so much to our lifestyle and who we are as an American economy and an American culture. We think that that in itself is very important. Pam is going to talk about what we feel is the moral obligation that American citizens owe to individuals who especially work within our borders, whom we do not provide the same sort of the same sort of rights to. So we think that the biggest harm with undocumented workers or illegal aliens is that there's no protection for them when they're working within the U.S. economy. We think that for example, not having the accessibility to OSHA and the safety regulations that those provide for workers, that OSHA can set safety regulations that say, well, you know, you have to have these types of hard helmets and you have to have these types of, this type of sleep or this type of supervision or things like that, that keep lives safe and keep people healthy. These undocumented workers don't have the ability to get a hold of that. We think that that's a great harm, especially since we are profiting off of the backs of these individuals. We also think that the chance for human rights violations is astronomically higher when we look at like the modern day slavery that we see in our own like Long Island and New York City, where people are used as like not just you know slave within the house working for you know as a maid or something like that, but locked in a closet at night, but also in you know modern day sweatshops that happen in the U.S. We think that that's something that again, when these individuals are adding so much to our lifestyle, simply isn't fair to be doing. We think that these individuals ought to be protected, and the best way to protect them is to enact this type of policy. So that individuals who've already, you know, granted so much to our lifestyle and to who we are have that ability to do that. We think that in addition to that plan, that we should be considering these illegal aliens favorably, especially because they've provided so much addition to their community. We think that especially if an individual has been an illegal alien for 10, 15 years, and they can show you what they've done in the community or how much they've added to the economy, though that would be very difficult to do considering that they are undocumented. The fact that they've been working, for example, in California for 10 years or 15 years helps us to realize why we're able to, in the middle of winter, no thank you, Matthias, to get avocados or oranges out of season for like a dollar a pound. Like that's something that really wouldn't happen unless we were able to take advantage of individuals like this. We think that because we have taken advantage of these individuals for so long, we now owe them the protections and the wages that they do deserve. I'll take your point.
You keep saying that we owe this to these people. However, these are illegal aliens, not just aliens, they're illegal. How come, if you want to add to the culture, why can't you merely do this legally? Why go above the law, beyond the law?
Okay, these individuals are maybe illegal, but madam, you can't deny that you have absolutely benefited from what they've offered to you in your community. And you know, they mow the lawns of those individuals who are legal residents. They pick the avocados and oranges so that we can do it cheaply and we can purchase what we have for so long. Like, we would not survive without these illegal aliens with the lifestyle that we have and the ability to purchase and consume as much as we can. We think that since our consumption is so high anyway, that this is it's our responsibility as a government to step back and say, no, these individuals probably deserve better than what we've been given them. They specifically deserve safety regulations. They specifically deserve the same types of ability to go to the police and say, look, I don't think my human rights are being restored at all, and here are some examples of being locked in a closet, or God knows what else that these people may be experiencing. So Pam and I stand on the side that responsibility in this case is extremely important, that the U.S. economy, U.S. people, U.S. government has definitely benefited from these illegal immigrants. We believe that now is the time to say, come on forward, show us what you can, what you've done. We thank you for that, and we want to continue to protect and affirm your lifestyle and you as a person. Thank you.
Okay, so the next speaker to open side of the opposition is Joshua.
We thank the Prime Minister for her introduction and her fun story about their prep time. Our waste of time in prep time was debating on whether or not we should try to speak in Irish accents or not. I think we decided that I really couldn't pull it off, but I might give it a go anyway. So, please don't feel insulted anyway. you said to do something fun, so I'm going to do something fun. It'll be pretty bad. But what we believe this motion does, Mr. Speaker, is that this really does. You've all heard the old adage: spare the rod, spoil the child. This is exactly what this motion is doing. The Prime Minister talks about what do these people really deserve. We believe, Mr. Speaker, that, and audience, we believe that these people deserve the consequences for their illegal actions. They've made these choices, and they're in these situations, these difficult situations, and we believe that they're suffering the consequences of their own actions, and we don't believe that they should be rewarded for their illegal activity. That's basically what they've proposed at this point. I mean, we've all come across the spoiled children, be it in elementary school, middle school, or high school. There's a person who feels they're entitled to everything. They were given what they wanted when they were young. They would complain to their mummies and daddies, oh, I want this, I want that. And the parent, rather than spanking them, would say, okay, you can have it, just because you really want it so badly. And they don't seem to understand this concept. You don't reward bad behavior, and this is what this motion does. What does this do to our society if we don't uphold the rule of law? I'm going to drop the accent. What does this do to our rule of law? When we disregard the rule of law in this country, what kind of precedent does that set? I mean, and we see it when we're raising children, we see it in society. We can't just condone illegal activity and brush it off as if it doesn't happen. And also, what does this basically do? It's trying to remove the illegal immigrant problem by labeling them as illegal immigrants, or letting them, or just giving them a pathway to citizenship. Sir. Not this time. It's sort of like calling a terrorist a man-caused disaster. Well, they're still causing a problem. They've still committed illegal activities, no matter what you name them, no matter what opportunities they get. I also believe, from my own personal experience, this is a slap in the face to my mother, who came here legally as an Australian citizen, went through the process legally to become a U.S. citizen. She spent seven years in this country going through the legal channels because she valued American citizenship that highly. She worked for it. She fought for it. And we don't think that you should give it away so easily to those who have come here illegally and dodged the system. They also talked about what they're giving back to society. They seem to ignore that many of these illegal immigrants are causing problems in this society. They come over as drug dealers, as pimps and prostitutes and gangs. Do they not realize what's going on in Mexico right now? There's wars, there's violence, people are dying on the borders of our country even as we speak, Mr. Speaker. And the other persons that they would give this pathway to citizenship to, what does this do to people who are already in this country? These people have not been, many of them have not been paying into Social Security. They have not been paying taxes. They get paid under the table. We would be putting all these people onto the rolls of Social Security, onto the rolls of our new healthcare program that is already so expensive for a debt-ridden society. You've been working hard. You've been paying your taxes. You want your healthcare. You want your Social Security. And now they're going to start granting these to these illegal immigrants who haven't been paying into the system, who have obviously engaged in illegal activity and are getting rewarded for their behavior. We're going to have a lot of spoiled children running around our society, and this sets a dangerous precedent for the future. But before I move on, I'll take you.
since they're illegal, they can't pay taxes because they're getting paid under the table. If we offered them amnesty, they would have legal jobs and be paying taxes into our system.
But at the same time, they would start receiving the benefits immediately. They would start receiving the benefits now, the benefits that they have not been paying for. They'd have to start paying for the health care, paying for the social... they'd start receiving the health care benefits. They'd start receiving Social Security that you have been working hard for. You have been doing it legally, and this is what they want to do. They want to take what you've worked hard for, what my mother worked hard for, and give it to people who have engaged in illegal activity because they feel sorry for them, because they're suffering the consequences of their own actions. That's not what we believe in on Signed Opposition. We believe that you should be held accountable for what you've done. You're out of order. We believe that you should be held accountable for what you've done, and that if you spare the rod, you spoil the child, and we can't afford a bunch of spoiled children running around our society right now when we already have so many other pressing problems at this time. Thank you.
Okay, next up is Greg.
Good evening, thank you all for coming to this debate. I have to begin with some rebuttal. Spoiled children? Really? In my experience, the spoiled children are the ones who try to get the cookies in the cookie jar and grab so many they can't get their hand up. That's a spoiled child. They're the ones who feel they are entitled because they already have so much in their lives that they don't understand what it's like to live without good food and clean water. These immigrants coming here are not spoiled children. The conditions of their lives before they came here are far, far worse than they're experiencing here. And when you accuse them as spoiled children, it simply places a stereotype which does not fit the circumstances of where they've come from in comparison to what they have arrived at here. And to go into my main points, we believe firmly that the opening government, or side proposition, has defined this debate very well. And we believe that, yes, the nation of America does hold a moral obligation to providing amnesty for these citizens. However, we believe it's for a rather different reason, and I'll go into that later. Essentially, we need to look at this from the point of view of the immigrants. And we need to back away from the legalistic idea of calling an action of crossing a border specifically illegal and deporting the border, and try to understand what they've gone through to get here, where they've come from, and then what happened to them when they got here. Now, why do illegal immigrants or immigrants come to the U.S.? Whether they're illegal or not, it's usually because they want a better life. Now, America has traditionally offered opportunity for this better life, a place where you can live with a good job and a home and provide security for your family and get education and clean food and water. And essentially, that's what illegal immigrants want. Not this time. Now, that's why they come here. But I would like you all to take a very close look at the risks that they undergo to get here. And I'll provide an example for you. Cuba. For years, children have climbed into life rafts, which were then cast adrift into the ocean in hopes that they would float to Florida. Why? Because they are willing to risk their lives so they can get a better life. Now, how many of you have grown up in a place where that can even come close to that? I certainly haven't. I've been comfortable all my life, and I think it's very unfair to think that we can understand where they've come from when we live here. And
on that point, sir.
No, not the same. And for that reason, once again, I say we need to look at this from the point of view of the immigrants as they come here and why they're coming from and what they have to go through to get here. Now, once they get here, they try to get a job. They try to get a home. They probably try to get health care, too, and welfare. But in the long run, they're going to be having a better life than what they had before.
Before you move on.
Yes, Bethany.
I mean, it's a very noble goal, but we have to be realistic here. We can't just give everyone the perfect lifestyle. Everyone can't be millionaires.
Well, if you think that I'm intending to make all these immigrants millionaires, you misunderstood the point. Not at this time. And finally, we need to look at the results of what happens once they get here. Now, there's two things. They've invested, first of all, in the nation. They've also invested in their own lives. How have they invested in the USA? Well, they get jobs, and the jobs boost the economies. I live near an orchard. I'm from upstate New York. There's orchards everywhere. And they hire Jamaicans, I don't know if they're legal or not, maybe they are, maybe they're not, to work regular hours to pick the apples in the orchards. Now, this helps the employers, this helps the consumers, this helps everyone. It also helps the immigrants, and this is how they've invested in their own lives. Because they're able to get a job, they're able to get the money to pay for the good food and the clean water, and they're able to provide security for their families, and they're able to get education. And overall, this is not the lifestyle of a millionaire. This is the lifestyle of a middle or lower class family or person who simply wants to have these basic fundamental needs in life. So they've invested both in the country and in their own lives by coming here. Would you, after watching this, then say to them, oops, you crossed the border, you are illegal, you must leave everything that you have and go back to where you came from? When they have come here simply on the same premise as legal immigrants, that they want the opportunities, but perhaps they don't even have the access to go through it legally. And it is for these reasons that we say to you that we should grant full amnesty to the illegal immigrants that are in this nation now because of the ways they have invested in their own lives and the ways they've invested in the USA. Thank you very much.
Okay, so where am I now?
It's the board.
So it's John.
Mm-hmm. I want you to picture yourself standing at the ocean. There's two girls out in the ocean. Each of them are drowning. When you go out there to save one, there's going to be only enough time for you to go out, swim out there, save one, and come back. And by the time you get out there again, the other one's going to have drowned. Which one are you going to save? It's a hard decision. But then I tell you that one of them is your sister. Which one are you going to save? The instinct is natural. You're going to save your sister first. Now, the other side may dress this up and try to say that, you know, these people have rights. These people are doing things in our society. But we can't save everyone. It's natural to protect your own. And that's what we need to do. We need to protect our own first, the people in America, the American citizens. We can't protect every single legal immigrant that is within our own country. Now, if other people come over legally, we can protect so many people. We can do so much for people in other countries. And that's why we have the system, for people to come in legally. But we cannot have a wide influx of people all coming in, because we can't take care of all of those people. But you would disagree.
Well, I just would like a little bit of clarification. You mentioned that we cannot protect these illegal immigrants. Can you please connect that to giving them amnesty and citizenship?
Well, I mean, there are a lot of things that go into protecting people. You talked about their rights, you talked about their jobs, you talked about their health care, you talked about all of these other things that these people, quote-unquote, need. But I would tell you that we have to protect our own people first in each of these segments. So that's what I want to get into. There's a few places that I want to talk about where it's going to be hard to protect people from both other countries and people within our own. You would disagree.
The fact is, we're protecting them by affording them basic human rights when we grant them amnesty. That's something that applies across the board. Rights aren't something inherently American. They're something that apply to all of us. That's not the understanding of rights that we have in our Constitution.
Well, I would tell you that I would like to give rights to every individual person. But that is without the bounds of our country. We cannot protect the rights of every single person out there. We can only protect the rights of a select few. It's beyond our means, it's beyond our necessities, not at this time. Now, there's only so many jobs in our country. And if more people come into our country and try to take those jobs, it's going to either lower wages or lower the amount of jobs that are available for the people in our own country. There's also healthcare problems. If we have a great influx of people, our system allows any person to come into the emergency room. And we can see a lot of hospitals in Texas, this is what's happening. We have Mexican Americans coming across the borders and coming into these hospitals that can't take care of all of them, not this time. They can't afford to treat all of these people. And it's causing hospitals to not be profitable, to not be able to take care of the people that are within our own country. And it's causing hospitals to shut down. There's also welfare. Now, the opposition tries to paint the picture of these people paying taxes into the system when they become Americans. But they told you the stories about them at this time, picking oranges, picking avocados. These aren't jobs that pay very well. And when these jobs don't pay very well, and they're not making a high enough amount of money, they're not actually going to be paying taxes. In fact, they'll be taking more welfare, more payments from the government than they'll actually be paying into the system, not at this time. So they're actually going to become a drain on the American economy, on the American government. The American government can take care of its own. It can take care of a select number of people, but it cannot take care of the rights of the entire world. And that is what the government would propose, that we take care of the rights of everyone. But that's simply not what's going to happen. We're going to attempt to save both. We're going to attempt to go out there, and in the process, everyone is going to drown. Thank you.
Thank you, team, for the first half of their speeches. Now we move on to the individuals. And the first up is the...
We are hardly spoiling illegal immigrants by affording them basic human rights. We don't feel that we drown by showing the sort of basic human compassion that we would show anyone. We feel that ultimately that illegal immigrants are afforded these same sorts of rights. The rights of the understanding of rights in the United States are not just something that you're given by having USA on your birth certificate. They are held as truths that are self-evident. Evident in the fact that you are human. These are human rights. These are rights that you have just by existing. This is not the way, it's not the conception to look at rights as something that you get protected because you're a citizen. But unfortunately, that's what's been happening to people labeled as illegal immigrants, that they're not afforded the same protections, which is why we need to grant them amnesty in order to allow for these protections that any human should have to be put forth. And when you can point, and when there are complaints about, well, they're a strain on the healthcare system. Yeah, it's hard to show, you know what? Compassion can be difficult. Compassion can be expensive. But that doesn't mean when there's someone that needs healthcare and comes in the door of an emergency room, that you turn them down just because of their status as illegal immigrants. You take them in because of their status as human beings. Now, what we want to get into is this point of this idea of the system itself. There are problems in the illegal in the system of immigrating into this country that cause for things like illegal immigration to occur. Now, when we think of immigration, the first image that pops into your head is the Statue of Liberty, the representation of the American dream, the representation of many people who have come in immigrating before. And it promises, and right on the bottom, it promises, send us your tired, send us your poor, settle to your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. But when you have a system of the INS that takes years to get through, that is incredibly expensive and takes a huge time commitment in order to immigrate legally, what we're saying is, give us your tired, but not too tired to fill out paperwork. Give us your poor, but not poor enough, but you know, rich enough to afford the fees, and have them huddled in the INS bureaucracy to have a chance to breathe free. And we ultimately feel that's the wrong way of looking at it. That's not up with our conceptions. That's not up with our standards of what we consider immigration to be. Go ahead.
So the INS needs reform. What's wrong with that? We can reform the INS without granting citizenship to all the illegals.
But when it's directly against the standards we have of human rights, when it's against what we promise of the American dream, we feel that that's inherently, especially when the system itself causes these sorts of problems, we don't feel it's something that you can just regulate away with the INS. We feel this is inherently a problem. Now, what we want to get into is also the fact that this system is racist. The persecution of illegal immigrants is inherently upon racial lines. Because when you see people concerned about their borders, they aren't going up to the Canadian border with rifles threatening to keep people behind. They are going to the Mexican border. They want to build a fence over the Mexican border. And not only that, and this actually negatively views Hispanics in this country with some presumptions that under this persecution, it cheapens and causes racial divides between Hispanics and non-Hispanics in this country. And we feel that when there's a status where in the system it shows conflict, persecution of people that illegally immigrated along racial lines can cause these sorts of divides. Now we feel that it's like that this idea, the spare the rod, spoil the child. Well, these people committed a crime, but we have to look at why. They're not in the criminals in the same sense that someone who committed a murder is a criminal. They're criminals in the sense that they've been burdened by a system that won't allow them to come into this country, despite our promise of helping those who are in need, despite our promise of human compassion, despite our promises of basic human rights. And we feel that, and this is ultimately wrong. And what we see in the status quo is the persecution of people along racial lines. And especially when we talk about illegal immigration as something that's inherently built upon this racism and it's politicized upon this racism, what we need to understand is this is wrong. And by granting amnesty and treating us all as equals, treating us all as people, and I don't think that's a very difficult standard to achieve, regardless of what opposition is brought to you today, we feel that by doing that, what we've allowed for is to better stand for the things that we stand for. Because we do not have human rights because we're Americans, we have human rights because we're people. And the best way to make sure that the human rights of everyone is protected, especially the illegal immigrants, some of the most vulnerable that sit in our borders, is by granting this amnesty and making sure they are protected. Because when we have the most vulnerable in society, that's when we truly show whether we believe in our rights and whether we're protecting what we really stand for. And if we do not do that with illegal immigrants, then that cheapens the rights that we all hold dear. And if we're really, and since even though we're allowed to let the Statue of Liberty, the Bronze Statue of Liberty, tarnish, we don't want to let our American dream tarnish, and that's why we are proud to propose.
Next up, getting 5 extra speaking points for being our host, is...
Alright everyone, well, welcome to the dungeons of the Empire State Building. Judges, not all it's cracked up to be, is it? Well, we just heard that we should give human rights, like healthcare and jobs and other things, to everyone. And what I'd like to say, or what seems evident to me, is that the real world has limits. For example, how long I can stay underground in this building has limits. How long this speech is has limits, and how fast I can talk as compared to the other speakers also has limits as well. So when looking at this question of should we give amnesty to these illegal aliens or not, I'd like to take a look at it from a different perspective, from just a question of what this action by the government would look like to the different parties involved. So, for example, what would our government be saying to its own people by giving amnesty to these people? Now, second, what would government be saying to the people outside? And finally, still no. What would government be saying to its citizens if, after a debate on this topic, we said, no, we shall maintain our laws?
On our statement?
No. So first, what is government saying to its own people by giving up the integrity of its laws? This has been pointed out by some of the other opposition speakers very well and in a very good attempt at an accent. So, if I'm an American citizen, let's say for a moment, and in some theoretical sense, I'm an American citizen, and I see my government say to 12 million people who have come here unlawfully, yet no, we do not want to deal with the pressure of actually enforcing our own laws.
Sure.
So we will simply change the laws so that you can be here legally. As a citizen, I begin to wonder, does my government have my interests at heart and actually maintaining the integrity of its laws? Or does it have the world on its shoulders? And this goes back to the answer that I'd like to give to the previous speaker. Government, man, the world has its limits. Healthcare has its limits. The American economy has its limits. And we cannot afford, in a single moment of frustration or of pressure, to say no, we will simply change the laws so that we don't have to deal with the implications of the laws that we actually have. I'll take you.
Illegal immigrants are illegal, so they will continue to subvert the system if they're made illegal. They'll work. They'll live in illegal basement apartments. They'll work illegal jobs. They won't provide to lawful decency that you're proposing.
Thanks. What seems evident to me is that the most subversive action that we can take in this situation is by giving up the integrity of our laws, as making a statement as a government that when the times get tough, we will not get tougher. We will, in fact, acquiesce. So, what is the government saying? What is the government saying to those outside? Well, the founding fathers of this nation, which seems to me to make sense to look at, said that this is a country of laws and not of men. A country where the democracy decides what the laws are, and then we maintain those laws. But again, what we are saying to those outside is, when the pressure happens, we are not ready. We will acquiesce. So we think that amnesty is not a message of hope or of humanity, as the government is saying. We think that it is a message of acquiescence, and we do not think that is a good message to be sending. So what does maintaining our integrity say to the world? It says that the democracy which so many lives have been spent to uphold will still have its integrity. This shining beacon of a nation of laws and not of the whims of men. That nation is still here and will still be here for you in 50 years, 100 years. That we will not set a precedent of acquiescing when times get tough. So, Mr. Speaker, we think that we have answered the question of whether or not we should give amnesty by just taking a look at what the interested parties might say, and we urge you to oppose.
Thank you very much. And next speaker is Hannah.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll be talking a little bit faster than Matthias, so please hold on to your hats and hopefully stay with me. My speech today is going to talk about how our proposition will actually help the system, but first I'd just like to introduce myself. My name's Hannah. I'm a St. John's student. Hello, King's College.
Woo.
I am obsessed with United States government and politics, as I'm sure my St. John's friends will tell you. Another thing I'm obsessed with, the census. I love it. I can't get enough. Turn in your filings. They're due April 1st. You can't file at your parents' address. You have to file where you're living in college. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you specifically about the census today, how this will help the system, how it will help every community, specifically immigrant communities, not only specifically also legal immigrant communities, which we see loads of all over New York City, and specifically Queens, where our college hails from, which is the most diverse county in our nation. Okay, so as we all know, the census is provided in the Constitution by the founding father, St. Matthias, to count each person living in the United States. Now, we see outreach being done to immigrant communities, specifically all immigrants, legal or not, this census, because it is of utmost importance to count everyone in the community, because what the census does is it counts everyone, and that's how we divide up who we give money, how much money we give to each community. That looks at where we're going to combine schools or maybe shut down hospitals, because these are tough economic times. So if we see a large population in Richmond Hill in Queens, and right now Richmond Hill has a very low turnout for people filling out their census, they're going to start closing down hospitals, which is terrible for that community, because we see a large influx of immigrants from Southeast Asian communities who refuse to turn in the census under grounds that maybe INS will get a hold of these documents and perhaps to try and deport them, when this is clearly not the case. We also see the census is important when it comes to redistricting. And redistricting is important because a lot of times in Queens and in Brooklyn and Manhattan, we see communities come together. We see Asian communities in Chinatown and in Flushing. And because of redistricting, we've seen in these last election cycle that this is the first time an Asian person has represented Chinatown in Lower Manhattan compared to a Caucasian representative. We also see that this is the first time in this decade that a Latino has represented Jackson Heights and Corona, Queens, and Asians in Flushing, and we see this is very important to reach out to those needs of the specific communities. Another important part of the census is that we know who is in the country, we know their income, we know what languages they speak, and we know how many family members are in, how many family members are living within a certain house or address.
So your problem is that illegal immigrants come in and use resources, and what we are going to do to solve it is to make illegal immigrants legal and reward their bad behavior.
So what they're going to do is they'll have more of an incentive to fill out the census. We'll know where to distribute the money to, because we see people moving away from counties from areas like upstate New York, where we both hail from, one of you, sorry, I forgot. But we see people moving away out of there and moving into more metropolitan areas like where we live in Queens, in Jamaica. We see more people moving into these areas, and these are the areas where in Jamaica, Queens, they're shutting down the hospital, two hospitals in that area, where they're still keeping the one in my hometown, which is probably unnecessary. So we see that this census is very important, and if illegal immigrants feel that their immigration status is in jeopardy by filling out the status, because INS will get a hold of it, so they don't turn it in. Right now, New York City has one of the lowest rates for census, turning in their census right now. In some places, it's as low as 2%. I think in Jamaica, Queens, where we're from, we're lucky if it's at 6% right now. So, no thank you. So the income for tax purposes is especially important, because we know if they'll have more of incentive to, that they will be paying taxes, because they have become, they'll have more of incentive to pay legal jobs, they'll have more of incentive to move into legal apartments, as I brought up in my POI against Matthias. And if people aren't turning in their census forms, then they're not getting counted, and we lose these benefits for everyone in the community, not just the legal immigrants. So we are helping the majority of Americans here by aiding them with the proper, out of order, with the proper representation, the proper funds delivered to their community, and we see this as clear benefits to doing this, besides the, clearly they think that this is, for some reason, that just by reforming the INS, that somehow this will, like, alleviate the system. I think that quite frankly, a ridiculous assertion to bring. So what I've brought you that is clearly important for illegal immigrants. This would help because they'd have more of an incentive to turn in the census, and the census is such an important part of how we distribute resources.
Thanks very much. Next up is Michael. Talking and swearing. Or is where possible. Unless it's funny.
Unless it's funny.
Okay.
Sorry.
I think he's got like 50 million.
Yeah. There's so much stuff in that plastic bag. 5 more speaker points.
Notice how the cookies come out when the answers you get.
Okay, whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to take a hit on the speaker points here, but whatever. I'm just going to come out and say, America, fuck yeah. It amazes me that on side government, we appear to have 6 Americans here, and yet they seem to have such a low opinion of what that means, ladies and gentlemen. Throughout this side, we have heard about how people come to America and let me clarify something for you as an immigrant, ladies and gentlemen. People don't come to America for basic health care, and people don't come to America to get jobs picking avocados in an orchard, okay? People come to America because this is the land of opportunity. People come to America because it is an incredible country to live in, because the opportunities you get in America, the opportunities that are afforded to me as a legal immigrant, are something that I couldn't get back home in Zimbabwe. There's something I couldn't get back home in India. There's something that I can only get here.
Sir.
And while the right the rights to health care and basic human rights, while yes, those rights may be universal, ladies and gentlemen, what I'm going to show you here right now is that the right to be an American is not a right at all. It is a privilege, ladies and gentlemen. There is no reason why you should be able to hop across the border and start demanding the right to be an American. There is no reason you should be allowed to enter this country illegally, avoiding the entire vetting process that you go through, and all of a sudden say, I want to be an American. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege, and that simply should not be allowed. What I'm going to talk to you about, ladies and gentlemen, is I'm going to show you how hard that vetting process is and why it exists. George touched on this when he said, we want your tired, but not too tired enough to fill out paperwork. Well, guess what, ladies and gentlemen? That paperwork is damn important, and I had to fill out a ton of it. Why did they make me do that? Why did I have to fill out that paperwork? Because the American government wants to make sure that I am worthy of the privilege of being allowed in this country, that I am worthy of being granted all the amazing benefits that come from being an American and being in this country. Ladies and gentlemen, they wanted to make sure that I'm going to contribute something positive towards this society. That's why we have those interviews, and that's why we have all those different paperworks that you have to fill out. And ladies and gentlemen, if we allow illegal immigrants to all of a sudden tell illegal immigrants that this is the way to get into this country, if you come in illegally, then, well, we're going to make you an American citizen, then what does that do to the vetting process? Why does it even exist anymore if that's what we're going to go through? Yes, Elaine.
Thank you for finally calling. Okay, we are not by any means disloyal Americans. We're simply honest Americans. We recognize that without these immigrants, we wouldn't have the lifestyle we enjoy today.
I love that you brought that point up, right? We wouldn't have this lifestyle of, like, cheap avocados or whatever it is that you guys have. Ladies and gentlemen, this lifestyle exists on the backs of illegal immigrants, not legal ones. Because this lifestyle exists on the fact that these illegal immigrants don't have those rights. This lifestyle exists on the fact that these illegal immigrants don't have those rights, and therefore they don't have to be paid the full wages.
On that point.
Which means that I don't have to pay extra to get all the products that illegal immigrants produce. The lifestyle you're protecting is not going to be protected if we make these illegal immigrants legal.
Sir.
We're losing it either way. No thank you.
Okay.
So no thank you. So, what was I talking about, right? Why is the vetting process important? Because we need to make sure that the people who come into America are contributing something that's very positive to the American society. Right? It's not just about basic human rights, it's about what kind of society America has. And right now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you, it's a great society to be in. But what happens if we enact this motion, if we make all illegal immigrants illegal, is that we allow the subversion of this vetting process. And what happens then, ladies and gentlemen? Well, then instead of studying the three people who work in the Zimbabwean embassy to make sure I got the right one, the one who gives the easiest interviews so that I actually get a visa to come to America, well, ladies and gentlemen, then I'm just going to fly over to Mexico, cross the border, and wait for another policy like this one to come along so that I become an American citizen that way. And that's not the way we should have it, ladies and gentlemen. Legal immigrants in America so that we know what kind of contribution they're going to make to our society, so that they've been fully vetted and we are entirely sure that they are going to be an integral part of our society and they're going to contribute something positive and that they're needed within this country. Ladies and gentlemen, I said it before and I'm going to say it again. America, fuck yeah. While basic human rights may be universal, being an American is a privilege and not a right. We should keep it that way. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much to all the individual speakers. Irish Times fame. Fuck yeah. Next up, back to the starting proposition team, is Pam.
We went, and I totally wasn't because I didn't know I was next. We give a value to people who are our citizens, and we grant them certain protections. They fall under our laws. And, you know, we talk about things like minimum wage laws or even having, you know, even things like anti-slavery laws, but things like Medicaid and health care. We grant those to our citizens and people who have invested in our community, who people who are part of our society. And we see that that value that we give to those people is cheapened. The value we give to our own citizens is cheapened when we don't grant it to everyone. So this isn't a value that we give. We give it to people because they're human. And I'm out of time. But so we look, we have a moral obligation to these people who have invested in our American government. So thanks.
Next speaker is Patrick.
Hello, thank you for coming today. The first thing I would like to say is that mama knows best. This is an old saying that we have learned basically since the beginning of our lives, I would say. And what I mean by this exactly is that, well, it's very self-explanatory, mama knows best. For example, recently with the Haitian crisis, my family has been thinking about adoption. My brothers and sisters are super excited about this. My brother wants 20 older brothers. My sister, she would like 30 younger sisters, maybe a million big sisters, as many as we can take, we want. No, not as, we just, they just want as many as there are out there. However, my mother knows best. She knows that if we are to take these millions of orphans, this would cause my brother and sister to not get fed. This would take away the bed of my brother and sister, and this would weaken our family structure. So when I say mama knows best, I believe that this can not only be transferred for my family, but this can be applied to the government as a whole. When we continuously allow these, I believe it's 12 million illegal immigrants that we have, this, in fact, is what is going to cheapen society. This is cheapening society because, A, you are taking away the jobs of the American people. These American people have worked hard. These American people are the American citizens. These are the people that need the jobs. But you would disagree, Greg.
I'm not too afraid to use myself for this example. I can tell you firsthand that I have not worked nearly as hard as some of the workers that I've seen on the Orchard Road.
You may sit down. For example, this past summer, I was applying for a job at this local restaurant. I happened to get a job as a busser, and I was working with two or three other illegal immigrants. During that time, some of my friends applied for the same job, and they did not get that, and they were legal citizens. It would be called taking away the jobs from the American people and giving it to the illegal immigrants. And first off, I think the very obvious thing that we have all missed is that this is illegal. This is going against the Constitution. This is breaking the law. Sit down. These people are criminals. People that break the law are criminals, and they deserve a punishment. What you are doing when you are granting them amnesty is you are saying, I'm just going to look the other way. But in fact, it's not just looking the other way. You are rewarding them for breaking the law.
On that point.
Sit down. When, how should we ever reward anyone for breaking the law? When you get a speeding ticket, you say, here's a $200 fine. You broke the law. There is a fine. When you kill someone, you may sit down, you go to jail for the rest of their life. There is not a reward. There is a punishment. However, we seem to think that we should be rewarding them, not punishing them for their illegal behavior, not punishing them, but instead giving them incentives to continue to do this. But you may sit down. Everyone keeps slamming this whole spoiled child analogy, but I would like to propose that we don't really have a full understanding of this analogy. Mama is the government. and the spoiled child is the person that continues to break the law. And then mama, who obviously does not know best in this situation, would continue to give them cookies or incentivize this. And this, of course, cultivates a society of criminal activity and a society of illegal activity. And what we are saying is we don't want this. We don't want a society of criminals. We don't want a society of illegal activity. If you want to do this, if you want to become an American citizen, do it legally. Oh no, you'll have to fill out a couple more pieces of paper. Boo-hoo, my parents have to file tax returns. We have to file all these other pieces of paper. Why can't we do this legally? I've heard the government say that we just need to keep granting them amnesty, incentivizing, all this stuff. Why not legally? Why not? I still fail to see why we can't merely do it legally. If you want the culture, if you want the avocados and stuff, and if you want the jazz music and whatever things that they bring, you can do that perfectly fine if it's legal. Why do we have to break the law to do this? This is something that I fail to understand. So on that point, I believe that granting amnesty to all legal immigrants residing in the United States would, if anything, be incentivizing and rewarding crime, which we should never do. We are a society of laws, as we have said earlier. Thank you.
Great, thanks, William. Only two speakers left. Next up is Alicia.
Laws are important. Procedures are important. Paperwork is very, very important. But here on Proposition, we think that something is even more important, and that is people and human rights and equality and affording equality to all people. We think that you can either view illegal immigrants as outsiders, as takers, as spoiled children, or we can see the humanity of these people and recognize what they give to society and treat them as what and treat them as what they deserve to have. We think that they come from deplorable conditions that are so bad that they are willing to risk their lives, as my partner brought up, to come into this country where they don't, you know, necessarily have the food, the clean water, the basic necessities that we in this country take for granted. Now, according to Nipun, filling out paperwork gives you more of a right to be in this country than risking your life to come here. We think that these people who find some opportunity in America, that they're willing to go above and beyond just this, like, and oftentimes they don't even have the opportunity to go through the legal processes. And so, like, if they're willing to do this, this means that they are finding such an opportunity in there that they should be allowed to stay. Now, a key point in this debate has been the role in society that these people play. We think that they often do jobs that are sort of menial labor with little protections for, like, the amounts of money that they make and, just like any sort of regulation on their job. And we think that this leads people to look down upon them as second-class citizens. And this is a problem that is largely ignored by people in the government. Like, we don't realize that the produce that we're getting or, like, any sorts of things that we're getting are built off the backs of these people working for less than minimum wage. And we think that we would like to believe that an American value is that everyone is equal, but these people are working without these protections and without this equality that we think is being afforded to everyone. But the opposition would say, like, but they're illegal, so they don't have any rights, and they don't have these same protections that citizens should have.
On that point.
But we think first and foremost, Mr. Speaker, they're human, and they deserve mercy and not punishment because of the situation that they're coming from and because the situation that they're going into in this country is one of, you know, that we would like to value equality and opportunity. Furthermore, like, deporting these millions and millions of people who are already in this country would be so problematic. It would devastate the American economy. And we think that since this is not a clear solution to the problem, we think that we have to recognize that they are here and that they are providing for American services to Americans, and we have to recognize this fact. Now, the opposition has said things like, you know, if they become citizens, they would be taking things from us. They'd be taking the jobs that Americans could have, or they would just, you know, not be paying into the system as much. But we think that they would be, once they become legal citizens, paying into all these social welfare programs as well. They wouldn't only be taking. And we're talking about people who are already here. These are people who aren't currently being turned away from hospitals or turned away from things. Like, this shows that we recognize their humanity.
Exactly. They're here. They're using our money that they're not paying for it.
great, but they are providing key services to the economy. They are doing things that, without which, America could not be the country that it is today. And we have to recognize that they aren't only taking, but also giving. And this us versus them sort of mentality that the opposition has, that has this dual nature, isn't truly the case, because the opposition would have you believe that every time an illegal immigrant gets hospital treatment, they're taking away one hospital treatment from a citizen. This isn't what's happening. It's not so dual. The more people who are in this community, the more people paying into it, the more life the community has, the more jobs that will be created. It's not as if there are only four jobs and, you know, American citizens are competing for them with illegal immigrants. There are, the more people in a community, like, the more we create. Who would have thought that America could support the 300 million people that it does right now, 50 years ago or 100 years ago? We think that they are an integral part of our economy and society and are doing services and will be paying back into all these social programs. I think that fundamentally, what does America stand for? It stands for the values of freedom and equality and opportunity. And we think that you can either value a piece of paper, something that just merely as a stamp on your passport that says you're here legally, or you can value a community of people who give so much to the country, who provide so many services that without which America could not stand. Mr. Speaker, we think that we are proud to propose.
Thanks very much. And last speaker for tonight is Jonathan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This motion is clearly an overreaction to a problem that can be solved much easier, like making it easier for illegal immigrants to become legal once they're already in the country. But I don't really want to talk about that, because talking about drug dealers is much more interesting. But before I move on to that, I'd like to talk about just really quickly of an undue advantage I have in this debate. I'm a dual citizen, I'm an American, and I'm a Mexican, and there's a lot of illegal immigration going on between those two. I'd like to talk about the kind of illegal immigrants this motion gives an incentive to continue moving on here. Drug dealers. Drug dealers are not the nicest of people in the world. I've lived most of my life in Mexico, and one day when I was driving back home with my parents, there was a pickup truck full of teenagers who had been mowed down with machine guns by teenagers for no reason. They were just irrationally continuing their rational behavior and killing people for no reason. Now, these people moved to the United States for a variety of reasons. One, to move their business to the United States, because that's where the market is, that's where the bucks are. In Mexico, there's only pesos, and bucks are worth way more, and there's a larger market. And two, they're trying to escape their law enforcement in their own countries. So, and also, they're also trying to escape other drug cartels. So they're moving their business into the United States, selling lots of drugs, and they're also moving a lot of their drug dealing problems. A lot of times, drug cartels will move into foreign countries outside the borders to kill people off.
I'm not going to buy the fact that it's somehow easier to deal drugs in the United States than it is in Mexico and these places. These drug dealers are just moving because that's where it's easier for them to operate. It's ridiculous.
No, they don't really move there because it's easier to operate. In fact, they move there precisely because it's harder to operate, and it's more, they get a higher profit out of it because it is harder. And the demand is higher for drugs in the North and in the United States than it is in Mexico, for the most part. Now, this motion, does add an incentive, because we're just unconditionally, just outright giving amnesty to anyone who's here illegally. If we're doing this, then anyone can just decide to, hey, it's easy, I can just move on here, and I am now a legitimate citizen of this country, just like that. I'm just doing it without going through the system, and we're turning drug dealers, murderers, kidnappers, just simply with this motion, into legitimate citizens with very little, no criteria at all, no reasoning. We're just turning criminals into legitimate citizens. Now, I'd like to, this debate,
It's not mutually exclusive to afford to those people who have added into our society some, like, protections, and then also pour money into, like, cracking down on the drug war, which we should be doing anyway. We can do both.
Yes, we can do both, but we can't just do this, pass this indiscriminate motion that allows criminals, murderers, kidnappers, to just become citizens of our country just like that. We can't do that. We can't just make legitimate citizens out of people who've not only come here illegally, but are also here to further their business. Now, this debate boils down to what you all want. Do you want your neighborhoods to be filled with drug dealers? Do you want your neighbors to be drug dealers? Do you want your neighbors to be mowed down with machine guns? I don't think so. I don't think you want these things to happen. And for these reasons, I know you will vote down this motion. Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much, everyone. If you don't mind, we're just going to take 5 minutes for two reasons. One, to decide the winner. Two, to come down off the ridiculous sugar high and burn down and throw soda and biscuits. And we'll come back in 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah?
Oh, thank you.
Are you guys
going to
go
wrong?
Okay.
Hold on.
Good job, Greg. Well, your
sense
is
good.
You should be afraid.
Good job.
My origin is
mine. Give me a second, I really want to record this now.
Oh,
okay. Oh, my God.
I caught it.
It's not recording. The media department will never know. Okay, it'll work this time, I promise.
I feel so stupid right now. You know what?
Thanks for waiting. Here's what we're going to do, if you don't mind. I'm going to give a little things to notice, then I'm going to announce the results. And the guys are going to talk more specifically about why we came to that conclusion for the winners. I just want to give a couple of very general overthoughts. The first is, genuinely, we were very, very impressed. For people who have had no exposure to this type of debate, apart from what we said, when you haven't even gotten to see one before, we were really, really impressed. With one thing in particular, which was every speaker's first minute or minute and a half was really, really good. I mean, most people that try and do this format struggle with the first minute and a half, and they struggle with the first minute and a half after having 10 days to prepare it. Like a minute, either a provoking line, a catching line, a humorous line, some of that, and every single speaker in their first minute either got a laugh, said something interesting, caught our attention, and that is the most difficult thing to do in a debate we're trying to win the crowd over, and for that we were very, very impressed. In terms of, and you should all know as well, it's a pity it's on camera, but I'll confess on camera, some of those jokes I'm taking home and I'm stealing them. I'm using them on my own. I suppose one quick thing, it's very difficult to do when you're used to certain style, but I suppose it happened tonight a little bit, where it's very easy to fall back into what you know, to fall back into that kind of British parliamentary style. Little things you notice, like I suppose in the Irish Times you would rarely, if ever, kind of say, Mr. Speaker, it would always be ladies and gentlemen, because you're always talking to the crowd, always in the crowd. It's a very difficult thing to do when you're used to speaking a certain way or using certain phrases to tie in. Those are little things like that. Or perhaps if you were to say, you would never say, as I refer to my POI, because the dog off the street doesn't know what a, well, I suppose the dog doesn't know much, but certainly the man off the street doesn't know what a POI is, so it makes a point of information. That's just little things that you get used to. Other thing I just want to mention briefly, because I know when I was talking to the individuals beforehand, they were kind of saying to me, like, to what extent can you make something different point? And I just wrote down a couple of examples of things that an individual could make a time out of. An individual doesn't have to rush. They don't have to, as you say clash on certain things. What will stop employers of illegal workers just firing them once they're legal, and just constantly employing illegal workers, if that's that's going to be, if the benefits to the economy are that they are illegal, surely they want to keep employing illegals. And that's something that you might not feel that you're going to win that point over the whole debate, but you might feel that you could get an emotive 7 minutes out of it. And you could take the shift off the worker, take the shift off the country, and actually just focus on the employer for 7 minutes. The type of person it is who employs persons, why it's beneficial for them. So I just wanted to mention that because I know some of the individuals beforehand were asking for examples. Or another one, for example, could have been to just talk about, even though it's paperwork, sometimes how important paperwork is, such as having insurance when you drive your car. You can drive your car without insurance for maybe 20 or 30 years and nothing ever happened. But someday, if you have a crash or if you're hit by someone with no insurance, that paperwork suddenly becomes very, very important. And the crime of not having paperwork or the crime of not having insurance didn't matter for 20 years, but suddenly when it is relevant, it comes up. And that's something, again, that you might want to do for the whole speech, but maybe if you have 10 days to prepare, you could come up with kind of emotive language. And some speakers did it very well. Instead of just referring to illegal immigrants, they kind of refer to the difficulty they had in coming to this country on boats and rafts and stuff. And in the Irish Times, you have